Welcome to this presentation on how to incorporate critical thinking into your academic learning at the College of Nursing. Most of you are new students. Some of you are returning students. I hope for all of you, you'll learn some strategies that will be helpful. I'm a learning specialist, not a nurse. I was hired over 25 years ago to help nurses, to help nursing students successfully complete their coursework and subsequently successfully complete that NCLEX at the end of their learning. So in this presentation, I've divided it into three parts. First of all, why do I need a learning strategies workshop, you might ask? How can I most effectively process learning in my classes? And how can I manage time to accomplish all these strategies you're teaching me? So part one, why do I need a learning strategies workshop? In these years of experience working with nursing and other healthcare students, I've been impressed by the quality of scholarship and motivation that learners bring to this experience. Admission to this college itself is something to be proud of. Merely to be admitted shows you're highly motivated and an excellent scholar. However, in many of the prerequisite classes that you've had to complete before you got here, it was feasible to do very well using just rote memorization. This, indeed, might be the first time you've ever been required to so deeply integrate and consolidate learning in order to apply information. It's new, and in short, I need to show you how to use critical analysis as you learn in each class and as you consolidate learning all the way through your experience at the College of Nursing. This workshop is designed to do just that. The strategies that I'll share with you are based on how the human brain processes and stores information. So we're going to take a look at what we do know about the brain and how it works. Notice that these neurons are interconnected in a series of neural networks. Another word for that is a series of schemas. It means a concept, an integrated concept. This is the way your brain stores learning in the long-term memory. And communication occurs when these neurons reach out with dendrites to find other like dendrites, and when they find something interesting, something they can relate to from prior learning, they communicate across the synapse. We know that that communication is electrical, it's chemical, it's physiological, it's biological. And you know that your prior learning in courses like anatomy, physiology, biochemistry has to be in place before these dendrites find something to communicate with. For example, as you start your pathophysiology course, you need to know normal anatomy and physiology before you can figure out what went wrong. So again, all learning is interconnected in the long-term memory. Since we know that, how can we work with our brains? Two things. Remember that all learning is interconnected, and remember that it's a chemical, physical process. So part one then was, why do I need a learning workshop? Part two is, okay, now that I understand how the brain processes, how can I effectively use what I know to process learning in my courses? To effectively process new learning, you'll need to understand at a deep level how the attributes of a concept you're learning in your healthcare field, in your nursing classes, are interrelated. An image you might keep in mind is that you are blasting information apart, pulling it back together, integrating it in a new way that facilitates critical thinking. Learn primarily using visual cues. We're visual learners. So most of us process learning more effectively when we can visualize the concepts in some kind of a chart or a graph. When I first started working with nursing students all those years ago, I studied the NCLEX and then tried to figure out what a brain would have to do to pass the NCLEX. So I designed the following chart, which you should have available also to you in hard copy to download off Integrity. And in that chart, I'd like to show you a visual way to imagine all the learning that you're doing in your nursing courses as you prepare for your NCLEX and in your career. First, I could see that from studying the NCLEX that it wasn't random, that if your brain deeply understood the differences between disease processes based on systems of the body, that was a good starting point. So your brain is comparing and contrasting diseases or pathophysiologies based, again, not randomly, but on systems like cardiac, respiratory, endocrine. That was pretty easy to discern. But also from studying the NCLEX, I discerned 5 different types of questions that I wanted to put together in some kind of visual scheme so that you as a learner would know the questions to ask as you progressed through new learning and formed new neural networks. And I could see that cognitively, it's a scientific method. It's a problem-solving scheme. And it starts with your favorite pathophysiology. That's the cornerstone. That's the foundation of all the learning that you'll do the rest of your career in nursing school and in your field. So let's take, for example, cardiac. So let's say you have failure on the right side, failure on the left side, opposing pathophysiologies. And to deeply understand them and know that you know and critically analyze them, it begins with the question, what pathophysiology causes the disease to begin, the etiology, and step by step to progress through the cells and the systems? How is the right failure different from the left failure? So of course you need normal AP to know what went wrong. And then cause and effect, scientific method, hypothesizing. Given the pathophysiology, what manifestations would I predict? Not memorize, but predict. It must make sense. The brain says, yes, that's logical. I like that. I can store that. I can use that. You're predicting what the patient would present based on what you know about the normal AP and the pathophysiology. And then, given the disease process, what lab values would I predict? Now, I separated these two out because lab values involve numbers and a little memorization of numbers. That's a different cognitive process. So don't just memorize lab values, but learn them in the context of the disease process. Finally, you get to, given the manifestations, what treatment plan would be most effective, and that includes the pharmacology. There's so much to learn in pharmacology, there's so many attributes, that I made a separate, an additional rectangular chart, which I'll show you on the next page, for the drugs that you'll be using as treatment for the diseases you're studying. So, for example, again, with cardiac, so you have ACE inhibitors, beta blockers, calcium channel blockers. For each of these, you need to know, to understand, and be able to articulate the mechanism of action, the therapeutic uses, and the side effects. But again, you're not just memorizing, you're synthesizing knowledge, and you're consolidating it by recording it on a chart in key ideas or cues, and then you're able to explain it to some willing or unwilling person who can hear what you know about it, and you know that you know. So again, the big picture, the pharmacology fits here, and you have, you certainly may download those for your own use as you proceed through your classes in preparation for the NCLEX and even out into the field and building semester by semester from patho to med-surg. This will help you keep straight the big idea as you learn and as you ask the critical thinking questions, the how, the why, the how, the why. Okay, those are important for deeply embedding the learning so that you will be able to apply it when you are out in the field. So, how can I most effectively use the tools I have, all my resources, in order to learn this way? Your textbook, your lecture, your labs, your study guides in pathophysiology, that workbook that you can get. These are resources, your peers, your instructors. But how can you use them most effectively? Before you even go to class, let's say you have a lecture on the endocrine system, So before you go to class, you look at the PowerPoint slides if they're available. You preview the text that goes with that lecture, and you're asking yourself the question, what do I need to review in order to really learn this material? So you go back and review the AP related to the endocrine system and all those hormones. And you're aware that if you have too much, it's hyper, and too little, it's hypo, and you're ready now to listen to the lecture. The Pathophysiology Study Guide Workbook, again, can help you. They have several different multiple choice quizzes that you can practice before you go to the first lecture. Take the first one, say, oh, I really need to review this. I don't understand the concept enough to even listen. Then you go to lecture and you use your PowerPoint and just take the notes you need to take in the margin, examples and so forth. You don't have to rewrite what's there. That's silliness. But just take examples down or anything that's not on the PowerPoint slide. The point of taking lecture notes is to use it later. Then you go back after class and you review the text if you don't understand something and to try to make sense of it. Or you might go to the STEPS meetings that afternoon after pathophysiology. Those are excellent for clarifying concepts. However, be aware that understanding it is not the same thing as knowing it. And that's where many of us get into difficulty, because the learning is not stored deeply in a way we can access on an exam. You need to be able, ultimately, to explain the concepts, the process, to another student, or again, another willing or unwilling person, or yourself, or the wall, or your dog. Dogs make really good listeners when it comes to reviewing the endocrine system. And then you know that you know. And when you know that you know, you go into the exam and the stress is reduced. Okay? So use your resources before and after class in order to understand the material so that you can then process it in such a way you can access later. So you've studied actively, you've used critical thinking, you've processed the concepts in a way that you can find on the exam, and you still clench when you hear the word exam. Does that sound like you? Or you start to take the test and you go blank. Has that ever happened to you? The issue is not the learning. The issue is the human short-term memory, and you can work with it. And I'm going to show you how. The human short-term memory is very, very limited. It's what you're thinking right now. It's the working memory. It's what you can hold in your head at one time. And if you're human, you can't hold much. Now, I can't see you, but I bet most of you look human. And if you're human, you have to work with the limitations of your short-term memory, either at the beginning of the exam to calm down, or in the midst of the exam if you begin to feel stressed. Your first task would be to minimize that fight or flight response, which, as you know, emits cortisol and it just really interrupts the synaptic communication. So you've got to get in control of that. And you can do that by simply breathing slowly in and slowly out as the exam starts, or as you find yourself getting stressed and anxious during the exam. Once you're in control of that fight or flight response, then there's some strategies that can help, and I want to show you those next. The immediate task is to limit what you're showing short-term memory, because the short-term memory can't hold much. So what I want you to do in these multiple choice scenario-based tests, which most of you have in all your classes and the NCLEX, is to start to limit what you're showing short-term memory by, first of all, covering up the choices. Now, some of you have computerized exams, and some of you have paper and pencil exams. But in either case, you can cover up the choices. I just took a practice NCLEX, and I actually held my hand up here, so I couldn't see the choices. So you can certainly do that. If it's a paper pen exam, just put a piece of scratch paper or your answer key on top of the choices. What you want to do is minimize what you're showing your short-term memory at each time. Okay. But even that is too much for short-term human memory. It can only hold 3, 5, 7, 9 items at once. So even though we're only looking at the stem, we still can get befuddled, right? You read the question and you get lost and read it again and it doesn't make any more sense, because what you need to do is not reread it, but circle the keywords, or in the case of a computerized exam, you can't circle the words, but you can jot them down on your scratch paper. You will have a whiteboard on the NCLEX. In a very few sad instances, you have nothing. You're not able to take anything in. And in that case, you'll just have to sub-vocalize the parts, keep them in your head, say them to yourself. It re-triggers short-term memory. Now, this one sounds a little counterintuitive, but it really works. Number three, after you have done that, you state, you put it back together and ask the question, so what are they asking me? And then you say, all right, brain, go find it. The brain retrieves it, what you want, because you've studied that way. And even that has to be dealt with, because the process of retrieving takes short-term memory space. So jot down what you think the answer is, key ideas about that answer. You've studied that way. So just cue words, pictures, a couple of phrases, just enough to trigger your long-term memory so it will retrieve what you want. Jot it down again on paper or whiteboard, and again, if you don't have access to either, then just sub-vocalize until you know what you know and it's in your head. Then you go through each choice separately. Now you have short-term memory space to do the critical analysis, to really think about what the answer might be. And that's what you would do one question at a time. Well, what kind of questions can I expect, even from the first semester? And some of you, maybe you're the first week of classes. What can you expect on exams? The kind of questions that you can expect on the NCLEX are the same kind you can expect on class exams. And because many of us don't have any clinical experience yet, I'm choosing some questions that you can kind of understand generically just to see how they're set up. The first one are questions for which the answer is based on patient autonomy. Autonomy, you know, the patient believes that you hear her, the patient feels that he has a choice, it's autonomy. Here's an example. The night before a hysterectomy, the patient says to the nurse, I'm worried I might die tomorrow. The healthcare provider's best response would be, okay, so remember my strategy. What are the key ideas? Hysterectomy, fear of death, nurse's best response. So I'm gonna, in my head, say the question now, what would be the nurse's best response if a hysterectomy patient is afraid to die? Okay, go get it, brain. What do you think? Okay, jot down what you think the answer is. Let's look at some choices. It's really routine surgery. Did you write down anything like that? Have you told your doctor about this? Did any of you write that? The thought of dying can be frightening. Did you write that? Or most people who have this surgery survive, so just suck it up. Are any of these the choices that you wrote down? As a patient, would you want to hear any of these choices? Which one lets you know that you're heard? And yes, it's option 3, because it encourages the patient to focus on expressing feelings, whereas 1 in 4 just dispute the patient's concerns. And number 2 gives away the responsibility to the doctor, whereas this is something a nurse would be concerned with. So option 3. So you've got your first NCLEX question perfectly correct. Good job. You can also expect questions, a lot of questions having to do with patient safety, and one of those is drug therapy and drug therapy safety. So here's another example. Before administering an influenza vaccination to a pregnant patient, the healthcare provider determines. Okay, so the key parts are flu vaccine, pregnant patient, before giving. So before giving a flu vaccine, I need to know what, as the healthcare professional. Jot down what you think. Do any of these match what you wrote down? Number of weeks gestation, vaccination history, family history of adverse events, or did you get at least two of those? If you did, then pick all of the above, which is the correct answer. If you're not quite sure, but you think you got two of them, then take the risk and do the inclusive answer, all of the above, and that's it. Good job. Now you got two right on the NCLEX. Remember, you have to care for yourself as a whole human person because, yes, your brain is chemical, physical. The synapses communicate with electrical stimuli that is based on your biology. But all of you is physical. All of you is chemical. All of you is biological. So what you eat and how much you exercise, how you plan study breaks, all of these can affect how effectively your brain can process new learning. So then we get to part three. Okay, this sounds great, but when can I do all of this? So let's talk a little about time management. You have access to a hard copy of this to print from Angel. This is what we call a weekly plan. It is just that, it's a plan. It's not something that's a straitjacket that you cannot veer away from. It's a strategy, an academic strategy, to help you know that you can get all the studying done, that you do have at least as many hours as the person next to you. And yes, I can plan my activities and my studying in such a way that I'm being effective and efficient. And when this workshop is over, I hope will take the time to try to finish this for yourself. You can come and see me individually if you'd like some feedback on yours. You'd start by writing in each class. And I actually have, when the student comes to my office, I have them pick a color for each class. It tells me sort of where they are, but it also tells you. For example, most new nursing students give the pathophysiology class a red. Okay, so you would box in the classes, pathophysiology 8 to 10 on Wednesday. You'd put a red box or whatever color you decide. That's the first step. Here's some strategies for the rest of it. After you write in each class, be sure to mark out your clinical time and identify the commute time. So you have to be at clinical at 4:30. What time do you have to get up? And unfortunately, that's not a joke, is it? But if you have to get up at 4 o'clock one day, what time should you go to bed the night before? Try to give yourself 8 hours. That's not a joke. That really is important because your brain needs sleep to function. Write in meal times. You do have to eat because your brain is biological, and so you need nutrition. Time with significant others. They're also an important part of who you are, especially if you have children. Sometimes I have students identify the child's name, maybe a sticker that's, you know, for Saturday afternoon is this child's time. And some people tell me they have adult significant others who are worse than the kids. So if that is true, you could give them stickers on your time management plan. But be sure that you identify the significant people in your life. And don't forget the lab time to practice. Sometimes we forget, oh, I got to go up to the practice lab and do some extra work. This may surprise you, but on your time management plan, if you don't take anything else away from the time management part of this lecture, remember that the research shows that when we process the kind of active critical thinking processing I've shown you, that it's 1.5 times more effective in the daylight. So if I plan 2 hours in the daylight, it would take me 3 hours at night to do the same amount of processing. So when you plan your schedule, strategize that pathopharmacology study time as much as possible in the daylight. The theory classes like pathopharm need some time to preview, get ready for it, look ahead as I talked about, see what you need to review. review before the lecture, and then some time to review as soon as possible after the lecture to make sense of, to comprehend, and then time for processing so that you know it, you've learned it, and you can explain it. Classes with written assignments are a different kind of cognitive process. You can break the written assignments up into blocks, steps, and you can do them at night when you're a little bit more tired, or on weekends. And seminar classes, just give yourself a few minutes, like the clinical seminar, to review your notes before you go in and write your clinical journal right afterwards before you go into your seminar. And it really tightens up the processing there, so you don't need to spend time that could be spent on Path of Farm. So I hope some of this will help you as you start your career. I wish you all the best of luck, and I appreciate your spending this time with me. So thank you, and good luck to all of you.